Yeah. Thank you very much. And that's a bit loud. Thank you very much for having me here. I've worked with badminton for many, many years now, but it's actually the first time I get the chance to get to this coaching conference, which I have looked forward to very much. And thank you for showing up, so many. Hopefully we'll have an inspiring and interesting hour here, and if that goes somewhat well, then maybe also tomorrow. Today we are going to talk about tactics and how to talk to the players about tactics and training tactics. And I don't know about you guys, but a lot of other coaches that I've talked to over the years, they find it a little bit difficult. And so have I found it, how to teach tactics. And I hope today that I can bring here and give you a tool that can make that easier for you in the future with your players. But as with any shot, any technical aspect, we can't just fix it like this. We have to practice, we have to train it, and we have to develop our players so that they also become good at speaking this language and using it. Okay? So I hope that you will join me on that. If there's something along the way that you don't understand, if it doesn't make sense, then please raise your hand and then we'll see if I can sort it out. And then in the end, hopefully, there will also be time for a little bit of questions to the whole session. Okay? Can we have the first slide, please? What I've tried to do some years ago, actually, because most of the Danish players, they're working with tactics from a very young age and are talking a lot of tactics. And with them, I didn't really need a tool or a common language because we had that already. Maybe also because it was in Danish. It's a lot easier. Probably a lot of you have found that it's a lot easier to coach like the smaller things in your native tongue than it is in a second language. But then I had to teach tactics to a bunch of foreign players and with a lot of different backgrounds. And there I had to find some similarities or some common things that I could talk to them about. And then I came up with this model. It has been changed a little bit over the years, but where I put this, my part of the court, I put this into three zones, I call it. So, as you see, the red zone is number one. That is when I take the shuttle in that zone. And don't worry, there'll be a lot of exceptions to everything I say today, because you can come up with a lot of different situations where it's not like this. I can be in zone one, even though I'm up here. But just to start off, to get a common language, zone one is when I'm low, okay, taking it low on court. Being under pressure. Zone two is in and around the net tape, like here. So it's a little bit more even play. And zone three is when I'm on top, I'm up here, I might have a chance to win the rally. So that's just how we start off. I'll explain a little bit more about the zones so we get to know them and also so we know what we should try to do when we are in those zones. Next slide, please. In zone one, that's when I'm under pressure. So I'm in trouble over here. You will get this and we'll just leave it up there and then you can, if you get forget a little bit or get confused, then you can have a look at it. I think it's easier if you look at me while I explain it and then just use that as a backup. That's the way I do it. So zone one, I'm under pressure. I'm in trouble. Okay? When I'm in zone one, I'm out of balance. And my opponent is in zone three. We'll come back to zone three, but it's quite important. And everything this that's on that slide is important. There's nothing extra. So everything has a meaning. Okay? In zone two, That was when it was even play. Then nobody's really on top, apart from that when I've done a shot from down here, like a transport shot or a build-up shot, then I'm a little bit above. My opponent is a little bit in trouble. But then when he's playing it back, then he's a little bit above, and I'm a little bit in trouble. So it's like 60-40, alternating all the time. Okay? But we just call it even play, 50-50-ish. Okay? And nobody, none of us, are looking to be able to finish the rally, to win the rally within the next couple of shots. That's a characteristic of zone two. Okay? Zone three, on the other hand, I have to be in balance. My opponent has to be in zone one. That means I can't be in zone three if my opponent is in zone two. So it's not only about my position on court. I can have plenty of time here and I can do my best shot. But if my opponent over there is in balance, he's in zone two, then it's not a zone three situation. Okay? And zone three is also characterized with or by that it's likely that I might be able to win the rally within the next two or three shots. Okay? All good so far? Then we go back to zone one. I was under pressure. What is the main goal in zone one? Please don't look at the screen, just answer from the bottom of your heart. What do you think is the main purpose in zone one when I'm under pressure, I'm out of balance, I'm in the red zone, I'm low, maybe here? What is the most important thing? Alive. Alive, yeah. I need to stay alive. That's true. I need to return the shuttle over the net and into the court over there. So that's the first purpose. And when I can do that, and that might take a few shots, and I'm in a little bit more control, then the second purpose, can you guess what that is? Yes, to go to zone two, or go a little bit higher in zone one, okay? Now we're in zone two, that was the 50-50 play, 60-40, even, nobody's close to winning the rally. What is the main purpose in zone two, do you reckon? You have to speak out louder. To get to zone three, yeah. That is what most players think is their main purpose and what they're doing all the time, but it's actually not, it's only the second most important thing in my book. Yeah? Exactly. The most important thing is that now I've just worked four or five shots to get move up to zone two, then it would be very annoying to go back to zone one in the next shot again. So that's the most important thing, to stay in zone two. And then, when I'm sure I can stay in zone two, then I can try to move up to zone three. Okay? Who can guess the next question? When I'm in zone three, what is the most important thing? Fuxi?
Stay there.
Stay there, yes, sir. I want to stay there because as long as I stay there, I know there's a big chance that I will win the rally within the next two or three shots. So that's a good situation to be in. And I also know if I'm in zone three, my opponent is in zone one, which is nice for me. Okay? What is the second goal of zone three?
Pressure.
Yeah, I'm even further. Winning the point! Yes, finally! After working all the way up through the zones, now I can try to actually win the point. Have you seen somebody down here in zone one, out of balance, reaching, trying to win the point? Have you seen it? Yeah, actually, a lot of people try to do that. Because they think, whoa, I'm in trouble here. I have to do something extraordinary, special to try to win. How often times does it work out well? 1 out of 1,000 or something like that. I don't have the exact math, but it's not very likely that it's going to happen. Okay? And that is one of the reasons why this, it's good to talk to the players about this, because then they actually get to know the situations. They read their own game, first of all, better. They also read the opponent's game, and they know, what should I try to do here? Is it always like this? Is this always the best way to play? It's a guideline, yeah. And if, as you can see, it happens very often that I'm in a much better shape than my opponent, then you could say, if I know that I'm physically better, my stamina is better than my opponent's, then it could be okay for me to stay in zone two, because then I'll win because I'm better in zone two. But for 99% of all matches, this is true. Then there'll be a lot of points that are not won from zone three. I mean, how does a service fault fit into this? Not very well. So there are a lot of things that can happen before we go through all the zones. But that doesn't change the purpose. We need to be able to read what zone we're in, and we need to know what we should try to do in the zones. Does it make sense? Lovely. Then I would like to introduce to you three very fit Swiss players. Please come on court, Christian, Ronja, and Toby. And these guys, they have volunteered to join the zones with us. And now we're going to show some exercises. And today we will show some exercises that are about recognizing the zones. So staying in the zones or knowing which zone you're in. Okay? First exercise here is very simple. We could actually start off just by feeding from here. I try to keep Christian under pressure, out of balance all the time. That means I cannot be a nice guy now. I have to work him very hard, okay? Yeah, are you ready?
I hope so.
Good. Now, I didn't tell him. If you were his coach, what would you tell him before? What is his purpose? What should he focus on when he's doing this exercise? Exactly, surviving, getting the shuttle over and in. Okay, that's right. Did he do that? Yeah. I think he did quite well, actually. So now we increase the pressure. And I put myself here and feed from overhead. Yeah, ready? Oi, sorry. There it was. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Did you notice something here? I'm playing in zone three, yeah, and he's still working in zone one. Was he in zone one all the time? Who says no? No, you're right. That's good. Why not? Yeah, but I agree with you. What was said from over here is that at some point he was moving closer to the net. Maybe I did a shot with not so much pressure, I think it was. And then he was actually a little bit in balance for a while. How about the first shot? Ronja, you can come in. How about now? Is she in zone one? Why not? She's in balance, perfect balance. She can't get a better balance than she has right now. Okay? So at least the first shot will be a zone two shot. Okay? And with the way I'm feeding, I can't keep her perfectly out of balance all the time. So she will be in zone two sometimes, and then I try to push even harder, because I also can't feed so that all the shots are going down, because then she's not really getting the training she needs. So we have to make the feeding suitable for the player, okay? Now, let's try to see how Ronja likes this. Are you ready? Oh, come, yeah, wait, keep going. Good. Three more. Oi, oi. Very nice. What did we notice here? She was in zone two more often. Why? Yeah, she got more time. Was I being too nice? Yeah, I was. And that was because Ronja didn't rehearse this morning, and she told me I'm not very good at this exercise. So, but she was lying, because she was quite good, okay? And then I turned up the heat a little bit, and at some point I turned it up too much, and that's what you have to adjust. And she was very good, because she didn't stop and frown and say, what are you doing? I can't do this. She just kept on working, okay? And that's the attitude we want, because you can't feed perfectly all the time. Or at least I can't, but I don't think you can either. And your players definitely can't. So we have to try to get the optimal pressure all the time. Okay? Good. Let's get all three on court, please. Toby, I think it's your turn to be over there, maybe. No? You'd rather stay here?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. We will still be doing some zone one training. I like multi-feeding for some exercises, and especially in the beginning of learning something. But as soon as we can, and as soon as it makes sense, I feel it's a lot better to do a one-shuttle exercise where it's not a coach or a player feeding, but where it's more like in a match. Okay? So now we will have, you probably all know the exercise, 2v1, one at the net, one in the back. They have to try to keep Christian in zone one all the time. That's impossible, I can tell you right now, but as much as or as for as long as possible, they should try to keep him under pressure in zone one. What should we tell him to do? Keep the rally going, survive. Secondly, try to sometimes place a good shot and go to zone two if possible, okay, or at least closer to zone two. Yeah, let's see how it goes. Just go ahead, guys. Okay, thank you very much. What do we say to these guys now? But you have to speak out very loud because it's dark and I can't see who's speaking and I can't hear it. So, yeah. Yeah, increased pressure. I agree. Yeah, because a lot of times he's in zone two. Why is that? Because he's a clever Swiss player. What does he do to go to zone two, Michael?
He plays a high
kick. Exactly. Yeah. Because that gives him time to go back to in balance. And then he's laughing at me saying, haha, I don't want to be in zone one. I'm in zone two now. So now I tell him, try to keep your lifts a little bit lower and try to keep the speed high. Okay? Good lift. Oh, good shot. In. Okay, one last rally. One more. Nice, very good. Our comment about trying to play the lifts more flat, did that change anything?
Yeah.
You like it more now?
Yeah.
Yes. More interesting now, yeah. And more according to the focus, that's true. And you could also see that now he starts challenging himself. Like he made a cross-court flat lift where he knew probably that I might get in trouble here if they're ready on the other side. I like to see that because then they start working together a little bit. We are going to talk more about that later. One other way of increasing the pressure could be adding another player or another coach, and we'll just try that. Ronja, do you want to go there, maybe? Yes. Yeah, just take a corner. Thanks. If you take the corner over there. So now we'll have two at the net and one in the back, exactly the same exercise. And you also challenge yourself by playing not too high lifts all the time. It's in. Oi, good. Good. Sorry. Okay. Did that change anything? Yeah, you're nodding. Why? No. Exactly. Did you feel like you were in zone one? Yeah, good. That's a start. Okay, any questions related to these exercises, to the zone one? No. What I've tried to do today is to choose some different kinds of exercises and also like different methods of training, so you can also get some inspiration there, hopefully. So it's not built up like on top of each other, it's just examples of how I would practice these zone focuses, okay? So now we go to a different kind of exercise, not 2v1, but 1v1, and then we have an extra guy outside. And then we do intervals. so we exchange. So what I would like the players to do now, and now we move to zone two. So now we practice to recognize when we're in zone two and to be in zone two. So this is a little bit like going to a different country. In the beginning, everything's new and you don't really know how to behave there. And then when you've been there for 6 months, then it's almost your home. So you don't think about how do I have to behave here and what is the language or whatever. So now we are practicing zone two play, and it's actually, everything's free. They just have to keep the speed as high as possible, and they are not allowed to kill the shuttle. And that means you have to have a feel for your opponent as well. So even though you have a very good chance, then you're not allowed to kill it. You have to play a shot that you think your opponent can reach, so you can keep the rally at as high speed as possible. Okay? Very nice. Christian, you come out.
Come in one. Come on.
Yeah, let's go. Change. Come on. Unless you really have to, then try not to make the high lifts. Just keep the pressure on the lifts as well. Keep going. Very nice. Yeah, change again. On you out. Okay, thanks guys. Any thoughts or comments about this? How did they perform? Were they in zone two most of the time? Sometimes in zone one, yeah. And what happened when they were in zone one? What did they do? Yeah, they stayed alive. But also that's when the a little bit higher lifts came. So the trick that Christian also used in one of the first exercises, to give yourself a little bit extra time, then you play a little bit higher lift, and then you're back again. I don't think anybody was in zone one for two shots in a row. I didn't notice. And actually, for I don't know if you are doing this normally, but if it's the first time, then they were very good at it. Because normally when I introduce this exercise to players who haven't seen it before, no matter the level, then it's very hard mentally for them to stay there. and actually to think so much and notice so much where, what's the position of the opponent. Okay? So the only small thing I adjusted, I don't know if you heard it, but when Toby came off the first time, did you hear what I told him? About the lift, yeah. So because I felt that sometimes he actually played the lift, maybe because he was getting tired or because it's a habit, but it was in a situation where he didn't need to take out the speed. And then we want to keep the speed. Apart from that, I was very, very happy with the quality here. Okay. Anything else you noticed?
Play a bit higher lift, or should I still play also play speed from the zone one?
In this exercise?
Yes.
In this exercise, you're a little bit safe because the opponent cannot kill it, so you can do slightly stupid things and get away with it. In real life, maybe you have to play it a little bit higher lift, mm-hmm. and that depends a bit on who you are playing. Because as I said before, if I am playing Victor Axelsen, then I'm still in zone one. If I play a high service from here, even though I'm in perfect balance, then he can put it so many places that I cannot reach that I'll be in zone one no matter what. So it's a little bit, if it also depends a bit on who are the players. But in this exercise, I would actually encourage them to try also to test their limits. What can we do here and still stay in zone two? Okay. Then you got a little bit of break, so we can continue. Let's have the boys on court. Now we move to zone three. And it's still, no, I'll just rewind a little bit. Apart from the zone training, the tactical training, what kind of training were we having in this last exercise?
Endurance.
Endurance, yeah. In what way? Yeah, they were all over the court. But was it just like compared to a run in the woods? Yeah, the thing I'm looking for is that it's intermittent work, it's intervals. So they were that's also why they were able to keep the quality and the speed very high here. And because we always get a fresh player on court, so he or she can actually set the standard. And they were not working for very long. I know it's tough, but they could actually cope with it and keep the quality high. Had we done two players just full time, then I bet the quality would have been lower. Okay. So that's also a way of mixing things up and keeping the quality if you add on a fresh player all the time. And the a little bit fatigued player knows that I'm going off next time. That is the I can go all in now and then I get a break. Okay, good. Still 1v1 exercise here. And Toby is the one in focus. And Christian is the feeder. Toby should work in zone three. What is the main goal in zone three? To stay there, yes. And the second goal is to win the rally. So if he stays on top most of the time, he has done well. If he wins some points, he has done very well. Okay. Toby's court, and we could have put some tape on, but these are clever players, as you've seen. So Toby's court is from here and behind. So Christian has to return everything to the rear court, okay, if he can. If he can't, then it's okay. He makes a block to the net, but then hopefully Christian is in a position to kill it because he's in zone three, okay? So he has to return everything to the back court, and Toby has to try to stay in zone three, or kill it afterwards. Let's see. Oh, yes, please. Three shots. Is it okay?
It wasn't a shuttle.
In. Okay. Last one. Okay, Toby, you come over here. Vanya, you come on there. Is it okay? Yeah. Vanya is the zone three player. Toby is the feeder still. Yeah. Okay, thank you. They were doing the same exercise, do you agree? I didn't say anything in between, so they must have heard the same, at least. Did it look the same? Yes? Okay. Do all agree it looked the same?
In front too. She was working in the front too sometimes.
Yeah, that's true. Was she in zone three almost all the time?
No.
No? Where was she?
Sometimes, maybe once in zone one, but sometimes in zone two.
Yeah, a lot of the time Anya was in zone two. How about the first one with the boys when Toby was over there?
Three and one.
Yeah, so he was in three and one over here. Yeah. So when Toby was working, I was very happy with the exercise. It was the way I had imagined it should look. Then why is Ronja in zone two almost all the time? Why is it not the same? Yeah, she doesn't have the same speed and she doesn't have the same attacking power as Toby did. So the level of the feeding compared to the level of attacking was a little bit too high. Can we do something about that? Apart from inviting other players in, or if I go in and do the feeding, then she'll be very much in zone three, I can assure you. I've got these three players today at practice, and I would like Ronja to have a good feeling about being able to succeed in zone three. One at a time. I think over here first.
Cut off the back court.
Cut off the back court.
Yeah, that was one good solution. Just say that the boys are not allowed to play to the back line, just to the service line. That's one idea. Yeah. Any other ideas? She could stay in one corner. Yeah, that's also, then it gets a little bit artificial maybe. Yeah, but it's it would make it easier for her. Yeah. Yeah, you could do that, or you could take half court, maybe. But we have to add another restriction, okay? Let's just try the one, Ronja, you go over there again, and then Christian, you can come in. Let's just try the one, same as before, you're playing everything to the rear court, but you can only play to the first service line there. Very nice. I just have one question for Ronja here. What is your main purpose in this exercise?
To stay in zone three.
To stay in zone 3, yeah. Was that also the main thing on your mind all the way through?
No.
No? I think you swapped the purposes a little bit. Like you have one smash over there and one smash here where you get a little bit too eager because you want to finish the rally. Yeah.
And I got the feeling that if the women is over there, then I can go to the court.
Yeah. What would you like to do next time? In those, yeah, think about staying in zone 3. Let's just swap the voice and then have a look at that. Lovely, very good. Perfect, thanks. Did that change anything? Did she become more in zone 3 now? Morten, were you happy with your adjustments here? Yeah. Was it different for you? Yeah. And the question I asked Ronja during the practice here actually, for me, shows what this can do for you. Because even though it's I saw her this morning, but otherwise it's the first time I see her practice, and we can still talk about tactical badminton together. And immediately after we had that little discussion, then she can change it. So she was actually playing much better tactically afterwards, because she just got reminded what is the main purpose of being in zone 3. So I hope that you guys can use this, and please use it as much as you can and as much as makes sense, because it's free. It's all yours now. So go out and talk to your players about this and show them, so they actually get to know how it is to live in this new zone country without having to think about it. Okay. Then I have three common mistakes or three areas where players have most difficulties in this. Any suggestions as to what those areas could be? We've just talked about one of them, actually. Yeah, and if we have to talk about everything, then it's you. The comment over here was going for the point, trying to win too early, and that's true. So you mix up the goals. You go for the second goal first, or you go for a goal in a different zone. That's even worse. Yeah, that's true. So mixing up the goals, going for the wrong goal. Yeah, that's one of them. What else? I don't understand that. They propose. Yeah. The purpose of the position. That's a little bit the goals as well. Yeah.
You want in a zone two, right? To keep the radius, and the players, they don't play too fast. They start to play slow and safe in the game. It's not fast anymore, just to keep the radius.
Yeah, if you sort of stay in a zone when you don't have to, that's true. And I can't remember if I said that in the beginning, but you always want to move up in the zones. So in zone three, you want to go to zone two when you can. From zone two, you want to go to zone three when you can. In zone three, you want to win when you can. Okay? But the one thing is the one we've talked a lot about, like having the wrong goal or going for the second goal before you have fulfilled the first goal. Second thing is, if you are misinterpreting your zone, like if I think I'm in zone three, but I'm in zone one, that will give you a lot of mistakes. If I think I'm in zone three, but I'm actually in zone two, that will give you a lot of trips to the basement, to zone one, where you have to work again. Or if I misinterpret where my opponent is, So they go a little bit alongside each other because it's, as you know, zone one and zone three, they depend on each other. So misinterpreting the zones. And then the last thing, and that happens a lot, and that's one of the areas where it's much easier to talk to the players with this tool than it was before. And that is when the players try to jump a zone. When in defense they think, okay, I'm in a lot of pressure here, so maybe I don't need to do a winner, but I need to do a shot that can get me out of the pressure and I can win soon. Maybe I'm a little bit tired as well in the rally. So I hope I can do a wonder shot and then I can kill it afterwards. It's my experience that that happens a lot and that it's much clearer to the players when you have explained them this, to see, okay, I can't do that. I'm skipping zone two. I'm trying to go into zone three immediately from zone one. Okay? These things are also going to be in your notes or in the handouts afterwards. So then you can do a recap. Yeah. Could you please come on court, players? Please give them a hand. I think they've done very, very well. Thank you. And then I think we have got a little bit of time for questions.
Yeah, we've got a few minutes if anyone's got a question.
What age can you start with this, with the zones? Explain. I mean, it's understandable that they can understand, but can you do the 10-year-old?
Yeah. Maybe not the full package.
No, no.
But you can start talking about zone one, when they're under pressure and what they should try to do. So it's Yeah, like teaching anything else, start with the small pieces and then someday everything you know, goes together and they can use it all. They have to have some shots first. I mean, you have to have something to choose from before you can start doing tactics. So at least 2 shots before you can start choosing between them. Yeah, but don't, I mean, just try, and if they don't get it in the beginning, then leave it for half a year or a year and then try again.
Got time for one more, if anybody's got a question. Yeah, up at the back there. Just wait for the microphone, thanks.
Any example for zone 2 or zone 3 for multi-feeding, multiple shuttle feeding?
For multi-shuttle feeding?
For zone 2 and 3.
Yeah, but that's a little bit like the first one, then I just have to feed it differently, so they have more time, and it, so there will be more clears, there will be more drop shots, a little less pressure. That's zone 2. Or zone 3, then of course I'll do some lifts, or maybe I want them to attack in some pattern or something like that. But again, when it comes to tactical training, it's a lot about being able to make one, that's not only one right choice, but some of the right choices in a given situation. So it's linked very much to actual play, and that's why I like these exercises a lot better in this.
That's great. Many thanks, Lars. Just a last round of applause. Thank you. Just got a small token for your participation. Just get a quick photo.
Yeah.
And Lars, if you can just present a small gift to the players for us, that would be good.
Thank you. Thanks. Thanks. Very good work.
Thanks a lot. That's great. Okay.